one time there was very little going on within the region other than some minor logging and fisheries. That was essentially it. But as of late, in the last couple of decades, we've seen a lot of interest from other entities within the world to access our place, to get uses out of it. You have the oil and gas industry, you have the renewable energy industry, there's a range of recreational structures that are building up here, from cruise ships to major sport fishing and recreational fishing opportunities. So the pressures are becoming quite substantial in terms of the marine environment. There are a lot of pressures out there, there's a lot of need for access. How do you best develop that? How do we want to use this environment, and what would be the best and most responsible uses of this environment?
The idea of integrated planning really comes from the UN Convention of the Law of the Sea, which was ratified in 1994. And one of the major bases for that was to ensure that coastal communities are connected to the resources that are on their doorsteps, and that independent fishermen have access to those resources, and that they're not just taken from the oceans by foreign countries coming in and fishing our coast. And the Canadian government's, you know, response was our Oceans Act that set out and tasked the Department of Fisheries and Oceans to take that leadership role and develop integrated plans for sustainable development on our coast to protect the ecosystem. So they have a mandate to lead that, and they really need to step up.
So we hope to get this plan in place to use that again as a platform to start some high-level government-to-government discussions where we can talk about fishing management, where we can talk about protected areas, we can talk about tanker traffic, and we can talk about all the various user groups that they want to use in our territories. And as you develop and urbanize and talk about liquefied natural gas and all these things, people seem to forget that there's a subset of society that is dependent and part of that ecosystem. And we're only now being seriously taken at the table. And there's a lot of relationship building that has to take place for us to make sure that we have a sustainable cultural economy that goes along with our need for job creation in our communities.
Well, marine planning is extremely important, so important that my council passed a resolution to support it. You need a plan, because haphazardly, we're not going to make it, and we being the planet.
With conflicts rising over ocean and coastal resources, new marine enterprises staking claims, and the need for better protection of ocean ecosystems, people on the British Columbia coast are coming together to better protect ocean, cultures, and ways of life. Led by First Nations and the province of British Columbia, this unique partnership has created marine plans to prepare for the impending demands upon the region's waters and to carry out a new vision of ocean stewardship. Islands, rainforests, wild rivers, cold water seas. Traditional territory of First Nations for millennia. The Great Bear Sea is home to 20% of the world's remaining wild salmon. Home to dolphins, porpoises, humpback and killer whales. Home to wolves, and the rare white spirit bears that live nowhere else on Earth. Welcome to the Great Bear Sea.
So we've always depended upon our ocean, and you know, there's a really close spiritual connection that our people have with the ocean. The killer whale, for example, has a really healing sort of aura to it. The people used to look at the orcas as, you know, their power and strength, that they used to draw from that. When people were really sick, And the orcas were going by. They used to take the sick people and put them in the ocean, in the shallow water, so that they could be in the same vicinity as these killer whales and get some of that energy from them on their way by in hopes that it would help them recover. The connection to the land and to the animals and to the birds, that really defines our culture, makes up who we are.
In the early 1800s, the Kittis Jews were out there in different settlements all over Ristable and all that out here in Higgins. Different settlements all over the place before we were taken again by the government into the reserve system. Well, they moved about. They moved about fishing. They didn't stay all over. So there's places for everything. All the resources of the sea mean a lot to us. Everything. The sea prunes, the cucumber, red urchins, we call them chuita. Those all meet a lot too. They're put away. Everything. Everything's put away, any kind of fish is put away for winter use.
You know, everything that we eat, whether it's intertidal, whether it's bottom fish, whether it's herring spawn, whether it's salmon, everything comes out of that ocean. It's a lifeline. It's a lifeline for our people. Look at the intricate life cycle that exists between all the species that are in there. And if you remove one, you start to have a collapse. It's like dominoes. So it's really important that we keep everything healthy so that these life cycles can continue on and thrive off each other. From the top of the chain to the bottom of the chain, we all depend on one another, right through the top, right down to the bottom.
All nations have to work together. All nations up and down the coast, the Haidas, Vancouver Island, the coastal people, nations have to get together and work together and work together and protect what little we have left.
Yeah. My name is Art Starrett and I'm the Executive Director for the Coastal First Nations. Our territories extend from our the mainland around the top end of Vancouver Island all the way to the BC-Alaska border. So it's about two-thirds of the coast of BC, and we're an organization that plans for the future. That's really what it's all about, that everything that we do has to be based on a plan. And so we began together, working together, on a plan to build, to breathe life into the rights and the title that we have in this region. We do that by land use planning. We do that by marine use planning. And so we began with a massive land use plan that became known as the Great Bear Rainforest.
In the mid-1990s, an epic battle over the clear-cutting of ancient rainforests, a battle which came to be known as the War in the Woods, raged along the BC coast. Lasting a decade, this conflict was finally resolved when the opposing parties arrived at a joint vision that created the land use plan for the Great Bear and protected 50% of the Great Bear rainforest. The strategy to resolve conflicts over natural resources by collaborative planning is now being put into action in the waters of the Great Bear Sea, where our demands on the ocean are stressing both the marine environment and local communities to the limit.
So planning, whether it's terrestrial or marine, is no different. Looking now, it seems like it was obvious we should have done this a long time ago. Forest companies started to realize pretty early on, particularly with the Great Bear Rainforest, that you couldn't just fight it. It had to be a joint exercise. A lot of the things that I do outside of the planning is restoration. And I learned quite early on that talking with First Nations and particularly the elders on what was there before was incredibly valuable information, and it steered a lot of my decision making. The relationships with First Nations now that we have in the Great Bear Rainforest are by and large quite good.
We have taken that blueprint for success on the terrestrial side and moved that over into the marine side. And that's where we always want industry to be with us. Whether it's the BC Seafood Alliance, which represents the majority of commercial licenses in the province, or some small sector, we want them all in the room. We want everybody in the room. We're pretty pragmatic. We recognize that people have needs. They have privileges they've been granted by various governments, and we recognize those as well. But they also have to recognize that we have rights that we're not going to allow to be undercut.
In 2008, the Canadian government signed a Memorandum of Understanding with First Nations and the province of British Columbia to develop integrated marine plans. This initiative is known as the Pacific North Coast Integrated Management Area, or PENCIMA.
We were able to convince the federal government to enter into a marine planning process, subsequently known as PENCIMA. And it made perfect sense for the First Nations, especially coastal First Nations, where the meat and potato issues are fisheries and habitat. And we are a coastal people. We've always relied on a coastal economy. And so it made perfect sense at that time. Through the different politics that Canada went through the emergence of certain projects and issues that became more relevant to the Canadian government, they essentially gutted the PENCIMA process.
We ended up with an industry that came into the room that was as big an industry as you'll find on planet Earth, and that's the oil industry. And the oil industry, whether they're coming by way of pipelines or whether they have ships that are trying to take products across into Asia or into the U.S., these people saw us as a real threat. And they began to come in and undercut the processes that we were involved in.
And so they walked away from the planning process, but we agreed that the issue was too important to wait for the feds to get comfortable. So the province and First Nations, along with the stakeholders of the coast, built a work plan amongst ourselves.
18 First Nations, the province of British Columbia, and partners on the coast forged ahead. And what began as a work plan became the Marine Planning Partnership, or MAP. After years of collaboration, on April 27, 2015, the province of British Columbia and 18 First Nations announced the partnership's marine plans.
Today, we are celebrating not one, but four marine plans, and not one, but 18 First Nations that are part of the MAP process. It's an impressive achievement, which was only made possible by compromise by every partner involved and a willingness to work together in a spirit of mutual respect and collaboration. Each of these regions have their own unique opportunities and their own unique challenges, and together they mark a milestone for the sustainable economic development and stewardship of British Columbia's coastal environment. They provide the province and First Nations a shared vision for future marine planning decisions, including planning for critical ecosystems as well as sustainable economic opportunity.
This is an important day for the Haida Nation, for the province of BC, and for all of our partner First Nations. The marine plans are a significant step forward in protecting the oceans around us for future generations and ensuring its sustainable use, and outlines a path forward that prioritizes culture, healthy, intact ecosystems, and sustainable communities.
We at the North Coast Skeena First Nations Stewardship Society look forward to working with all levels of government to implement our plan priorities during the next phase of the Marine Planning Partnership.
For our nations, implementation of the MAP plan is a beacon of hope on how governments can work together and to protect and sustain the natural resources. We are proud of the work that we've accomplished with the province over the last 2.5 years, and we're excited for the work ahead as we turn these plans into action. So thank you, Jessica.
We do wish that the feds were able to engage us at this table, but our message is pretty clear, that we're going to decide what's best in our territories, and we're prepared to share that dialogue with whatever levels of government are prepared to meet us at a level of respect and transparency.
The Marine Plans designated 4 sub-regions within the Great Bear Sea. Haida Gwaii, North Coast, North Vancouver Island, and the Central Coast. Join us on a journey to meet the people and communities that are now embarking on the challenge of making the Marine Plans a reality.
So welcome to Dish Jew. So this area is really important to my family. I actually have one of my grandparents that I've never met that's actually buried here somewhere. Nobody's really sure where he's buried now. This is actually an old big house. And you can imagine a nice roof over this and walls and everything. This would be the entrance. One part of the story, they talk about the strength of the big house, and they describe 4 grizzly bears holding up the big house. So that's what this looks like to me. And this is only one of the villages that are around in this whole area. There's just unlimited access to all the resources that are out there. So you got all the rockfish and halibuts and all the neighboring salmon streams and all the fresh water. So it's the perfect place to have a village and survive. This is a good example of our existence, and that we've always used this area and always used this coast, and you'll see it everywhere.
Our people, the Haltsik people, were a traveling nation. We didn't stay in one spot. We packed up our entire home, our entire house, and we packed it up and we moved to different locations. So we followed the seasons. We followed the food and we went to wherever we needed to. Today we're traveling the highways of our ancestors, looking for ganas and looking for crabs and picking medicines and cedar bark picking, seaweed picking.
There's a number of us that go out, family units, just to harvest for elders and other family members when those that can't afford to go out, so, or don't have the vessels or the time or energy. So we usually harvest a fair amount for the purpose of sharing and trading.
They're in grade 3-4 and we're taking them out to pick some of our seaweed, which we call black gold. And our people have been harvesting seaweed for many, many, many years.
And they're highly regarded by not only ourselves, but others. So yeah, it's a vital part of our diet.
But this is the best. My father-in-law used to go, her dad used to go to Nalu Pass in the first week of April and get the best kind of seaweed. It was nice and black and shine.
So all of those aquatic resources, land-based resources that you see in our traditional territory was what attracted our people here. So we lived off the fat of the land, the aquatic resources, be it halibut, shellfish, you name it, everything. You know, abalone, sea urchin, sea cucumber, all of those my people used. But you know what the government did. They came with management, they're the stronger group, and they practically ruined almost everything we got. I mean, we struggle now with aquatic resources. We really struggle.
Yeah, we can't continue down that same path and then how things were managed prior to now. We've got one of the most pristine territories left in the world in the Great Bear, in the Heltzik territory. And we want to protect what's left. We've got to strike this balance, and it's very difficult. You know, we have to be profit-oriented, but at the same time, we have to consider our environment. We have to, and the value of that environment is part of our balance sheet. We look at that environment as a way to sustain us now and into the future.
I remember the first battles for the Great Bear Rainforest back in the 90s, and I was still in high school then, and I remember going to some of the meetings that they had. You know, a lot of the forest companies, you know, had a schedule to come and log the Great Bear Rainforest. It was known as the Great Bear Rainforest back then. But at the time, you know, my community basically said that, you know, we have plans for our land and for our water, and when we talked about protection, we talked about protection for both, and we didn't really see land and water as two separate things. But unfortunately, the way the provincial and federal governments work, that's, you know, land is provincial and feds is water. So we had to separate the two in order to come forward with some solid protection. So I think we started working on the land use planning first. And, you know, back then we looked at about 50% protection for the territory, which is huge for the area, but wanted to protect, you know, the values that the Kitisew Hayes people had in those areas. So we picked some very key areas and looked at protecting, you know, all the species within those areas, including the forest. So now we have about 47.5% of the Kitisew Hayes territory locked up in protected area. Now we're able to sit down with forest companies and determine where forestry is going to happen, and making sure that those forest companies aren't impacting food areas, cultural areas, ecological areas. So that's been very important. And I think now we want to kind of translate that sort of management onto the marine side. By developing these marine spatial zones like we have on the land side, that will help us protect multiple species and make sure that, you know, those species continue to be there, and not just for First Nations, but for everyone. We wanted to make sure that there was a place for commercial fishermen, recreational fishermen, for food fishermen. All of us have stewardship responsibilities. Doesn't matter whether you're First Nations or non-First Nation. So it was really important that, you know, we set a good balance.
The marine plans initiate that balance by protecting marine ecosystems and supporting economic opportunities that can restore nature and communities. They are a starting point for a different kind of economic prosperity, one that can endure generation after generation.
It was important that we start doing our own science, and we start partnering up, whether that's with the province and whether that's with different academic institutions, to start gathering the proper data so we can make proper decisions. Just this year alone, we're doing salmon work, we're doing rockfish, we're doing Dungeness crab, we're doing bears, and we're doing birds. And we're investing hundreds of thousands of dollars in some of this work. And, you know, it's not cheap, but it's going to help us make sustainable decisions. And I think that's really what's important to the community.
With the understanding that we depend on a healthy ocean to sustain us now and into the future, the Heltzik Nation is working with researchers from Simon Fraser University to determine if a commercial harvest of kelp can be done sustainably.
So the kelps are an important form of structure in the ocean. So they provide habitat for a lot of different species, like commercially important fish species, other invertebrates like sea urchins, abalone, cucumbers, those kinds of things. And so essentially, if you remove that habitat structure of the kelp, there's concern that there's impact on these other species that inhabit the kelp and feed on the kelp. So So we're looking to determine how much can be of the kelp can be taken from these ecosystems without impacting negatively the other fishery species in the ecosystem and also the carbon storage and flux value of these ecosystems.
First Nations had been investing a lot of time, intellectual capacity, knowledge, both traditional knowledge and scientific data, to make marine use plans that the communities were comfortable with and were really community driven. There was a collection of scientific data that included bathymetry data, current data, and also biological data like the occurrence or presence of sea ducks, herring, kelp forests, all kind of mapped spatially. And that was made available to anyone who wanted it to identify areas that were ecologically important, important to commercial fisheries, important to the tourism and recreation sector, and areas that were culturally important.
We're looking at science in a new way. We're able to take traditional ecological knowledge and local knowledge and merge that with the best available Western science. As stewards, we have to look at the best way of gathering all information before decisions are made, so.
Collaborative science, paired with traditional and local knowledge, is central to the marine plans and will inform decisions on sustainable economic development and stewardship of British Columbia's coastal environment. A strong emphasis of the plans is long-term employment in shellfish aquaculture, community-based fisheries, marine-based renewable energy, and marine tourism.
It's not like we are saying no to business, but what we're saying is no to destructive development. That's going to destroy our ecosystems and our environment. We're doing business in a different way so that when you want to come into our territory, you know that there's going to be a viable opportunity here long term. And that if industry, whether they're independent or larger corporations, work with us, we know that we can guarantee a long term access to whatever resource is in our territory. But we have to protect what's left. It's very important.
The ecosystem has to support itself first before it can support anyone from the outside. So the conservation needs to maintain the species that are here, to maintain the people that are living in it, you know, whether it's a First Nation or a non-First Nation community. And then if there's surplus that can support people from the outside, then by all means, I mean, then there's those opportunities. So this has allowed people to take stock, I think, in marine planning in terms of all the resources. So all that detailed work was done at looking at every resource, what needed to be protected for conservation, which areas, what system of protection was necessary, which areas were important culturally for people to access for food. And then, of course, you identify certain areas as well that can support certain types of industry, whether it is shellfish farming, whether it is finfish farming, whether it's a marine hydro project, you know, with a turbine and a tidal turbine. Wind power is being looked after in terms of energy needs. So all of these things are being kind of looked at into the future.
The North Coast area is facing development issues like we've never seen before, with the race to move liquefied natural gas out of BC to Asian markets, with the Northern Gateway Enbridge project to move dilbit bitumen to Asian markets. It's putting a lot of pressure on the North Coast area, you know, in terms of transportation issues of large tankers, in terms of terminals in Kitimat and Prince Rupert. It gets back to the fact that these marine use plans that each community has are very, very important to be able to put your community's voice forward to decision makers in government, to stakeholders, and really to the world. that we have to make right decisions, and that those decisions need time. And unfortunately, you know, those time frames do not always match up with our capacity to deal with those issues. It doesn't always match up with our community's decision-making process.
Canada is a trading economy. Our economic livelihood depends on our ability to trade with the world, and the Port of Prince Rupert is that gateway. We really see our role as facilitating and enabling Canada to fulfill its trade objectives and to keep the trading economy going. And Prince Rupert is being looked to as the solution to many of North America's and Canada's trade challenges. And as a result, we've planned for and we foresee, you know, tremendous growth. And that with that growth comes jobs. I mean, the liquefied natural gas industry is a good example. North America, British Columbia, has a lot of gas that is, quote, trapped. And the only way it has value is if it gets to international markets. And this region is viewed as one of the gateways to those international markets.
We're in the what we refer to as the estuary of the Skeena River, or the mouth. The tide runs up the Skeena River about 60 to 80 kilometers. And so basically what's happening here is it's all the mixing. It's the mixing of the fresh and the salt water, it's just really, really, really productive in terms of juvenile salmon coming out, but also for shellfish and everything like that also.
Three-quarters of harvested fish and shellfish species depend upon estuaries during their life cycle. The greatest threat to estuaries is by far their large-scale conversion by draining, filling, damming, or dredging. These activities result in the immediate destruction and loss of essential marine habitat. In and around the Skeena River estuary, major industrial developments are now proposed.
People here have a very close tie to the region, to the water itself, the marine environment. We are people of place. There are families here that go back many generations, whether it be First Nations or European. Many of us live off of the resources from the marine environment here and don't necessarily see what's being proposed as a fit for us. If government is allowed to move forward with industry in terms of how they see the future, then this will be a complete industrial site. This will be a massive industrial zone all around Prince Rupert here, the Skeena Estuary, and the surrounding areas. You'll have massive LNG development, you will have massive oil by rail and pipeline out of here, you'll have massive coal being distributed out of here, you'll have massive everything going out of this place, but there'll be no consideration given to the marine environment around it. We stand to lose many things, but I think what is probably first and foremost in many British Columbians' minds is our salmon, the wild salmon that presently exists here. We have the Skeena River, the second largest salmon producer in Canada and one of the largest salmon producers in the world. It's untouched, it's undammed. This is an incredible piece of water with a major productivity.
Currently, a lot of job opportunities that are being presented to our communities. The natural gas industry will require tens of thousands of people, literally, to build that industry. Oil companies are coming along and saying, if we build a pipeline, there will be thousands of jobs. And, you know, because you First Nations, you don't have any jobs, you know, we'll train you and you can go and build pipelines. You can build natural gas plants and so on. The problem with that picture is that these are not jobs that are going to be around in 10 or 15 years. They're going to be gone. So you've got a population of people who have been involved in a couple of monocultures, one in the fishing side, which is salmon, and one in the terrestrial side, which is logging. Those industries, they used up all the natural capital in those and left us there with nothing. That took about 100 years to do that. We are now looking at industries who are coming along that have about a 10-year shelf life. It'll take about 10 years to build a natural gas industry. And those 10,000 jobs that we've trained our people for, they won't have jobs after that. So it doesn't make any sense for us to retool a whole population to do a job that is not going to exist. We've been down that road. We're not going down that road again.
When I came on board, this was a little over 2 years ago, this LNG was just starting to put through applications for referrals. And on our table today, we have 19 major files associated to major activities. Not all of them are LNG, but the majority of them are. There are so many issues related to LNG that we have to address on the stewardship program. We have to address the air emissions that come out of a facility that uses 100% power from gas. There's a disposal at sea air issue here when a facility goes into site and has to remove some soil and they want to pump it back into the ocean. There's the issue with the port in establishing additional anchorages outside of their boundary lines without consulting Metlakatla. There's the issue of shipping as it relates to the potential for ships to come out of Kitimat and out of Prince Rupert.
Marine traffic is estimated to increase threefold over the next decades along the British Columbia coast. The Marine Planning Partnership is asking for a comprehensive analysis of the inherent risks and impacts that are associated with increased ship traffic, and for an emergency response plan to reduce the threat and impacts of an incident.
We have actually a lot of shipping right now in BC. We don't even have to talk about enhanced shipping. There's enough out there to warrant investments. I used to be the environmental emergency planner and analyst for the BC Ministry of Environment for the last 20 years, with a particular focus on marine oil spill response. And that segued into looking at marine vessel casualty in general. We haven't looked at the whole matter of coastal protection as it relates to marine vessels, whether it's the marine vessel casualty, the ability of all vessels and not just the oil spills, as well as chronic impacts or operational impacts from noise, sound, and emissions and invasive species. Another example is chemicals. We carry chemicals and bulk and carriers. Chemicals are very much a big part of a container vessel casualty, and we don't have a marine chemical response regime yet. We don't have that capability. And that's one of the reasons why MAP is stepping out and talking about marine vessel casualties, all types of shipping sectors, all types of cargoes, all types of risks, to bring it into the context of good coastal management, good coastal planning, and bring it in within their overall planning strategy. And then once you get that in going, then you could ask the right questions and make sure that there's action being taken.
So integrated marine planning provides that framework to do that. From the Commercial Fishing Caucus's point of view, which there's 13 different organizations involved in that, there's issues on two sides. The ecological issues, an ocean that is very complex, climate change and ocean acidification that's changing that ocean. On the other side, we have the socioeconomic issues. From a fisheries point of view, we're a traditional user of the ocean space. We've got all different kinds of new users on the ocean space. We have the energy sector, renewable and non-renewable, pushing for access. Recreation users more and more pushing for access. We have aquaculture pushing for more access. So we have a variety of different challenges to face when we were, a traditional user and had full access to the marine space. Marine Planning Partnership, provincial jurisdiction doesn't cover fisheries, and so it's been taken off the table for that kind of integrated approach. So we've had discussions with First Nations directly on fisheries issues, and we're working with Coastal First Nations on a coastal fisheries strategy to identify a common vision for fisheries on this coast, for First Nations and for fishermen on this coast.
Certainly we recognize that we're living in a world economy now, but we also know that there are things within that region that are going to be valuable to the world economy. So we're building this sustainable tourism industry. We're building a sustainable shellfish industry, a sustainable salmon industry, a sustainable groundfish industry, but incrementally. Building it up slow so that you can't tear it down quickly. If you build stuff up too fast, it falls real fast.
The development of shellfish aquaculture has been identified as a sustainable economic opportunity in British Columbia's waters. The marine plans designate management zones for shellfish aquaculture in all subregions of the planning area.
This marine planning was developed to identify the best uses of the ocean. And BC, the north coast of BC, has a lot of potential for shellfish industry. There, you know, we identified many places where the shellfish aquaculture can be developed as a sustainable business. It's not only tourism or fishing activities. Aquaculture has a place here in North BC. We found out that the water quality is and the environmental conditions are very, very good for the aquaculture development. Coastal Shellfish Corporation is a multi-million dollar project. We currently have two sites with a total of over 200 hectares. So we're gonna put several hundreds of long lines in the tenure. So we are planning to grow many millions of scallops in there. I would say the most important production of shellfish product in Canada.
People really want to see responsible use in terms of the environment here. They want to see sustainable industry, industry that won't affect what we presently have, so that we're building on what we have as opposed to removing from or watering down what we have. So there's a great deal of concern over that. The MAP process, the Marine Planning Partnership, I have a little more faith in terms of the ability to at least implement it because it is a smaller plan. It's really between two governments, although communities would like to think of themselves as a third level of government within that structure. Also ensuring that that which we value the most is protected, and that's our access to the marine environment and the rich foods and tradition that it provides us.
So the bottom line is Metlakatla wants to be able to protect the lands, waters, and resources so that their membership can harvest in perpetuity. And that's what the stewardship program is doing, is to make sure that the children's children's children can go on, access that sockeye or that seaweed or that halibut, knowing all this industrial activity is still ongoing. And that's our plan.
In the face of all of these proposed developments, we can't ignore the fact that we still have unresolved rights and title issues with the federal and provincial governments. And really, in the end, I think that's where a lot of First Nations want to end up, with the ability to self-govern, with the ability to manage our resources as we did in the past, with the ability to determine what we want to develop in terms of an economy, what we want to protect in terms of certain ecological values, and how we want to evolve our culture.
Monumental poles are more than just art. They hold histories, they mark events, and they tell stories.
I think an important part of management planning, right, or agreements is, of course, it's implementing the plan, but it's also around celebrations and affirming, you know, your relationship, you know, between the partners. Here at the site of an ancient Haida village, Sea Lion Town, or Kyolnagai, we've built this cultural center where visitors can come and learn about, you know, how Haida people feel about Haida Gwaii and our ocean.
I am weaving a chief's robe that we call the Nahin. The pattern that I'm weaving and creating with this particular robe is Gingi or Ginga. He controls the ocean and is leader and ruler of many sea creatures, and he also controls the weather. Our ancestors really depended on his benevolence. We have, as Haida people, as indigenous people, been really concerned about our environment and our ability to provide for our great-grandchildren and our grandchildren and the future generations. We look back at our stories that our ancestors told of the power of the ocean and the reverence and how to be respectful. These stories aren't ancient tales that don't connect to our world now. They really remind us that in order for our abundance, we thank our ancestors, and our grandchildren are going to thank us, hopefully, for our caring for our environment. So I think it's very important to continue our traditions in so many ways, in so many respects.
You know, we've seen a lot of changes in the waters around Haida Gwaii, and the plan is our effort to maintain Haida Gwaii in a state that future generations can enjoy it the way we have. The vision is founded on respect. Yakudung is the Haida word, and that means respect for the landscape. It's also respect for each other, and it's also, you know, respect for all the creatures. The living creatures here in Haida Gwaii. There's several aspects to the vision. You know, one is protection. Another one is ensuring that we have appropriate economic development here in Haida Gwaii.
The world is as sharp as the edge of a knife. There's a fine balance when it comes to resource extraction. We would love to get our people back onto the water a lot more within the fishing sector, but not at the large industrial scale, which is done more commonly today in other areas. The idea is to have more communal-based fisheries, having the species that are harvested within our territory actually delivered to our docks within Haida Gwaii and processed by not only our people, but other residents that work on Haida Gwaii as well. That'll really enhance our economy a lot more than it's been in the last few years. In Haida territorial waters, on average, annually, the landed catch value is about $89 million or so. And it's a very, very small percentage. I think we'd be lucky if it's even close to 2% of that revenue hits Haida Gwaii. So it comes out of the waters that surround Haida Gwaii, but that revenue isn't hitting where it should. And it's our belief that a lot more of it can come through here and be processed and marketed through a Haida brand.
Haida Wild is part of a longer-term vision for gaining greater local benefits from the fishing that occurs in Haida territory. Marine planning is about supporting and growing these opportunities, while at the same time ensuring long-term cultural and ecological protection.
We need to be able to use whatever that resource, that marine resource, gives us as much as possible on the island. We have a plan for how we deal with the sea around us. And on island, well understood, well documented, well researched solution to how we handle the waters around Haida Gwaii.
Like the other sub-regional plans for the Great Bear Sea, The Haida Gwaii Marine Plan identifies zones for the protection of key marine ecosystems. These protection management zones eventually will become part of a larger network of marine protected areas throughout the Great Bear Sea.
Marine protected areas are particularly important because they do provide places where we can have healthy, intact ecosystems. And that's a benefit not only for the ecosystem itself, but as well for ecotourism and fisheries. Fisheries are probably going to be the biggest beneficiaries of marine protected areas. The science from around the world is showing that if you control or stop fishing in marine protected areas, you're going to have more fish, bigger fish, and overall healthier marine ecosystems. And some of those fish are going to spill over into the adjoining areas where fishing can still take place. And so we have had a particular focus on how can we properly plan that network, bring all the best available, not only kind of Western science, but local knowledge and traditional knowledge to that process to design a really robust network of marine protected areas.
The way we've done the zoning, there's many areas you can fish, and what these protected areas do is they provide an insurance policy for the ocean. They're protecting biodiversity as well providing resilience to climate change or other stressors which affect the marine environment. Protected areas are recognized as a necessity worldwide. Here in British Columbia, we've made limited progress on establishing protected areas. So we see the Haida Gwaii Marine Plan, you know, as a way of laying out where we're going, you know, here in Haida Gwaii waters, you know, on protected areas and taking a step forward in protection of the ocean.
I definitely support this plan. I signed on to the Marine Advisory Committee because I believe really strongly that we need to do things differently, that what we've done to date around marine management has not always been successful, and we have many examples of stocks in decline in terms of fish that that suggests that we're not managing things particularly well at the current time. There's a lot more support locally than I thought there was going to be. That one protected area lays over an area that all of us charter fishermen use, and I thought there was going to be a lot of opposition to that. Since some of the places on the East Coast that we're identifying protection are some of my favorite places to go fishing, but because they're pretty amazing places, I think we should protect them before we deplete them. So.
I really love this place, and I really want to see the communities and the ecology, like ecological communities and human communities, benefit and do well over the long term together. So this place, like many other places on the coast, has a very long history of people being part of the ecosystem. So in this case, over 10,000 years with the Haida. And so our society has maybe lost its connection with place. And so this is a way of reestablishing local communities and their say in what happens to their place.
Okay, you guys ready? Done. One, two, three.
It's such a powerful moment watching the pole go up. It shows that our way of life is continuing. The world around us is always changing. but the meaning behind what we do stays the same.
We know that if we can get our ecosystems back in balance and make sure that we don't pollute the water, make sure that all of the nutrients that that are required in the ocean and the rivers and the lakes and everything that feed our salmon and feed our halibut and feed everything that's there, if we can get that balance back, the natural capital that exists in that region will begin to bear fruit for us again. And that's the objective that Coastal First Nations has. That's the objective that we have in the terrestrial side. That's the objective that we have on the marine side.
We've sort of built our economy through diversification over the last 10, 15 years when things started to fall apart economically. We started to diversify into like ecotourism, kayaking, whale watching, bear watching, etc. You know, if you're going to have tourism, then you have to have compatible uses happening around it.
Through the marine planning process, people in British Columbia have created a joint vision of ocean stewardship for the North Pacific coast, one of economic prosperity that can endure over generations. As we face questions of how to best manage our ocean resources, the marine plans in place can help us avoid conflicts early on and guide us to find the best path forward in shaping the future of the Great Bear Sea.
So if we can avoid that conflict from the start by having the provincial government tell these people, nope, sorry, this is not a good place to do this, and then we just avoid it all. So it makes my job easier. And it certainly saves the people that are wanting to live there or wanting to develop there, saves them a whole lot of money in going through the process, and it saves the provincial government a whole lot of money. So it's just a win-win all the way around. So
it's so important for us to see this through. The allies and relationships that we built through land use planning and carrying on through marine use planning is really going to be the only way forward. If we can get all the user groups together and on the same page, we're going to be able to make some decisions that are going to work and stand the test of time. It's going to take the provincial and federal governments to be a part of it too, but this is something we're willing to do ourselves. But just the state of the ocean and where it is and the decision makers that are around the ocean, we need that to be a truly government to government discussion. But we will start it, and we will show the leadership and use the relationships that we built to implement it. But to implement it properly, it's going to take the buy-in from both the provincial and federal governments.
Today we're fighting to leave something behind for our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren, and we're fighting so that they have a sense of who they are and where they come from, and we're fighting to keep our traditions and our culture and our language and our songs and dances alive. I hope that the people who have leadership roles treat people kindly, treat people with respect, treat people fair, so that we could strengthen each other on the coast and work together.